We're reaching out to all sorts of experts, and we're happy to have with us on the phone Jay Lund. I spoke with him about another story having to do with the behavior of the YOLO bypass and how well it's performed. Jay Lund is joining us from UC Davis, a watershed expert. Jay, thanks for your time. Just your overall take on what's happening right now. How big of a deal is this?
It's a pretty big deal. People that are being advised to evacuate should definitely evacuate. There'll be a lot more clarity on this by morning. I think they're doing everything that they should be doing right now, getting people out of the way, just, you know, because there's a significant probability that they'll lose a significant part of that spillway.
Yeah, can you explain to people, Jay, just in terms of the emergency spillway? Obviously, it hasn't been used before, but this is an unpaved spillway, right? We're talking about a lot of debris that's going into the Feather River, correct?
Yeah, there'll be a lot of debris in the Feather River, a lot of sediment coming down that hillside from using the spillway. What they're trying to do right now, as I understand it, is to lower the level of the lake through the gated spillway, which is, as we all know, has been damaged. So they're running that at a higher level, trying to get the lake level below the elevation of the auxiliary spillway so that it stops spilling over the top of it and so stop the erosion downstream of it. And that way, if they're successful, they'll be able to look at it tomorrow and ascertain quite a bit better what the condition of that spillway is. But I think right now they're doing the right thing, getting everyone out of the way. If my family were there, I would definitely get them out.
Sure. Now, Jay, tell us a little bit. Put this in perspective for people. What are we dealing with here? How much water are we talking about? Some people how they react to things. Obviously, there are going to be many people who say, I don't think I really need to get out. I'll just wait it out, see what happens. But how much water are we dealing with?
There's enough of a chance that you could
Absolutely.
Have a pretty big wall of water coming down
Yes.
Through there, essentially doubling or tripling or more the flow that they're releasing now. Which would probably overwhelm some of the lower levees if that case were to happen. I think there's a high enough chance of that I would, if it were my family down there, I'd definitely get them out.
Sure.
We're talking with Jay Lund, a watershed expert from UC Davis, who knows everything and anything about this. He studies this stuff when we kind of just see it as a passing interest. He knows it from A to Z. Jay, from a standpoint of Sacramento and what could happen, you know, down the road, obviously we want to not push the panic button, but the system is set in place where you have the Fremont Weir, correct, to the north,
right,
and the Sacramento Weir. So can you talk about that and that system?
Well, the fortunate thing about this particular event, the next couple of days, if you had a fairly catastrophic thing happen, losing the spillway at Oroville, I don't think there's any chance of losing the dam itself, but losing the spillway at Oroville and have a very large flow, you're looking at several hundred thousand cubic feet per second coming down that river. The people on the Feather River should be very concerned and evacuating as they tell you to. But by the time it gets into the Sacramento Valley proper, we have a very large bypass system, the YOLO bypass, Sutter bypass, that should be able to accommodate even pretty disastrous floods coming down from Oroville.
So, Jay, in your opinion here, what they're doing right now should be enough to try and at least hold this off until morning so that they can get a good idea of what they're really dealing with here when it's light out, correct?
They're trying to do that, but
yes.
If they don't succeed, you will want to have everybody out of there tonight.
Absolutely.
Jay, one mention, and I don't want to get bogged up in numbers, but you talk about CFS. Am I correct in what I heard that the amount of water, they can go up to 210? For CFS in terms of the water from the spillway?
I'm not sure what it will be. It could be quite a lot. I haven't heard any official calculations on what it could be, but just some quick back-of-the-envelope calculations, and given the volume of water behind that spillway at the upper elevations, it could be quite a lot. And quite likely, if it were to go in a big way, it would be more than the downstream capacity for some miles.
And can you explain what the process is, the dropping the rock-filled containers? I know, you know, from a layman's standpoint, you get it, but exactly, you know, what exactly will they be doing?
What they'll be trying to do is to shore up where it's been eroding so that if so that any remaining spillage over the top is less likely to be erosive, and also to prepare for, in the coming week or so, if that emergency spillway has to be used again, to make it so it's less, make it so it's harder to erode down below.
And Jay, we're speaking with Jay Lund. He's a watershed expert here who's able to clear a lot of this up for us. For those who are at home right now who maybe haven't been paying attention to as closely as many have in the last week here, talk about what we're dealing with here, because I think that there is some confusion. Some people do think that this is the dam that's having an issue when that's not the issue. This is the auxiliary spillway. Can you talk us through what we've been dealing with for the past few days and where we are now? Just bring us up to speed from beginning to now.
So every large dam, and Oroville is the second largest dam in the state, largest reservoir in the state, has to deal with a whole wide range of events. For the past 5 years, we've been dealing with drought, and we haven't been thinking about the higher elevation spillways hardly at all. And so normally what you try to do is release as much water as you can through the hydropower plants, which makes money for the state and the people of California. But the elevations this year have been high enough, inflows have been high enough that they've pulled the reservoir way up to the top, been able to pull the reservoir up into the normal flood control pool, and they were operating the gated spillway, which is some distance from the dam itself, and they had a partial failure of that fairly far down the apron, the spilling apron, down near the Feather River, and they... So they cut back on the releases into the gated spillway. That caused the water to back up in the reservoir while they tried to figure out how much they can release down that spillway. And they found that they seem to find that they can get about 50,000 cubic feet per second down that spillway without erosion, although right now they're operating it quite a bit higher to try to bring the water level down below the emergency spillway. I think it was yesterday or so. They started running the emergency spillway for the first time ever in the history of the dam. The emergency spillway has a lip of concrete along the top, and towards the southern end of it, it's one end of it next to the gated spillway. It's a pretty tall lip, maybe 30 feet or so, and it's never been run before. But they were running, I think, maybe 10,000, 12,000 cubic feet per second over it, and it caused some erosion down at the bottom of that concrete part, which is where they're worried about causing structural failure for that part of the auxiliary spillway.
Mm-hmm. And Jay, let me just leave you with this last question. We appreciate your time, by all means, we're going to reach out with you again if perhaps we can as we continue our coverage. As far as timeline goes, what's your best guess on when people might be able to start coming back to this area? I mean, obviously, daybreak will have a lot of answers, but if you're leaving right now, you should expect to be gone for, a few days at least?
You'll know a lot better by tomorrow morning, probably mid-morning, I would guess. Give them some time after daylight to go and see what the condition is, assuming it hasn't broken overnight. And if it's broken overnight, then you might be gone for several days, depending upon how far the flooding has occurred. If it does break in a big way, the lake will drain very quickly within a couple of days, I would guess, two to four days. Otherwise, they'll be running fairly high rates, and they might want to keep people evacuated until they're sure on the structural capability of that spillway.
It's a big job ahead, and all eyes are on the Oroville area. Jay Lund, watershed expert, spending some time with us. Thank you so much for explaining all of this and for going through it all step by step. It's definitely a help and gives people some great perspective. So, Jay, thank you. We will be reaching out again to hear more of your expertise as the evening wears on as well. So thank you so much.